where it left to go to a state of being derelict. I think the building, what then are we preserving? We're preserving something that has no benefit to the community and actually starts to become an eyesore. So I think redeveloping a building in this way, which I think, again, I'll say is I'm perceived to be tasteful and in keeping with sort of the style. I think they seem to have gone to great lengths to keep the changes at the front to a minimum, whilst at the same time sort of, you know, getting a viable unit out of it. I think it's to be considered a good thing, and I would be looking to approve this tonight.
Any other comments?
Chair,
sorry,
I'm
talking a lot.
Fascination. I do sympathise with Dave because I have some. I do have concerns because when you have conservation area, you have some very set plans and very strict regimes. They're there for a reason, to protect it. And when you see deviations from it, you do get bothered, and you get nervous, and you think, you know, why would we bother? I've seen good and bad examples of these type of communities. Good example, and I wouldn't have voted for it if it had come to committee, was the new build on Port Select Village, Osborne Court. It's virtually very difficult now, and I spend a lot of time on the village. People can't pick out what's the new build and what's the old one. So you can do, we're talking about the new units at the back. It is possible to build so sympathetically that over time, the only thing that makes them look is that they're slightly newer, but as they wear there, they do blend in. So it is possible to do new build in a conservation area and not lose any of the properties. We've seen bad new builders on Bromborough Pool Village at the top, and everyone knows where the boat really used to be. They are a bad example of not keeping the nature of the village. So this seems like a sympathetic scheme. And where you don't get a commercial value or commercial ability to replenish these listed buildings, they gradually fall into disrepair by the nature of not being used, by the nature of things that go on in our society. The next stage that comes to these buildings is what we call safe ruination. I've got an example of that in my ward. Is Playbrook Chapel in the middle of Playbrook Church had to be safely ruined, so it's basically a shell of a building. And I don't want that to happen here. So to me, it's whether this commercial plan will yield enough investment to protect what is the main feature, which is the old school building and the old master's house. And I think, given, you know, I've heard of these, we shouldn't talk about this, but I've heard of these people before. I think it can be done in such a sympathetic way to relieve Matt when on the visit and has reassured me that it can be done sympathetically whilst maintaining the overall nature of Eastern conservation area. I think this is what that would be a success. So my view is to vote for maintaining and getting commercial use of these buildings that will protect them for the next 100 years.
James?
If nobody else wants to, can I come back? Thank you, Chair. I did say I did have a recommendation that I would like to move in relation to. Please don't get me wrong in thinking that I'm against any development taking place here. Even the conservation society in Eastern Village, not against any developments taking place. You know, we're quite happy for it to be looked after and maintained. What we're looking at is the infrastructure in the centre of the village. The material change to the frontage, as much as Matthew said, it's only minimal. We put an extra front door, two extra front doors in, put an extra two windows in, and we elongated all the windows that are already there. So that, to me, is a really material change to the frontage of the school. And that goes against the ethos and the principle of the whole thing of protecting the conservation of the area. But I'll now give you my reasons for refusal. The residential conversion of the school buildings, nothing to do with anything at the back. The school buildings were, by virtue of the external alterations and adaption proposed, particularly to the front, which is south-facing elevation, detrimentally affect the setting and integrity of the Grade 2 listed building. Listed for its special architectural and historical character, to the prejudice of the visual amenities of Eastham Conservation Area. The proposed development is therefore contrary to Policy CH1, Development Affected Listed Buildings and Structures, Policy CH2, Developments Affecting Eastham Village Area, Development Affecting Conservation Area, and Policy CH10, Eastham Village Conservation Area, of the Wirral Unitary Development Plan, and the Principles of National Policy Planning Framework. That's my reason. Refusal. I would like a second if we could get one.
Okay, Councillor Mitchell has moved refusal. Is there a seconder?
I'll second that, yeah.
Thank you, Jim. All those in favour of refusal? And against? That's lost. So the officer's recommendation is to approve, subject to the conditions listed. Paul?
I'll move.
Thank you.
I'll second it then.
Thank you. All those in favour of approval? Against? Okay, that's carried. Thank you. If we now move to agenda item 6, Mellor Road, Prenton. Matthew, can we have a presentation, please?
Thank you, Mr. New Chair. This application was the subject of a member's site visit on Tuesday. It seeks permission for the change of use of the building to 5 self-contained flats. The original proposal sought permission for 6 units with a 2-storey extension at the rear. Following concerns raised by neighbours, the 2-storey extension was deleted from the scheme and the number of units reduced to 5. An existing single-storey extension is to be replaced with one of similar scale, the only difference being that it will be 30 centimetres deeper and the ridge will be 1 metre taller. The existing garage door will be replaced with windows. These changes are not considered to have any detrimental impact on neighbouring communities or the street scene. 5 one-bedroom units will be created and a small yard area to the rear provides space for bin storage and secure cycle storage, the details of which are conditioned for further approval. There is no off-street parking provided with the proposals. However, given the small number of units proposed and the one-bed nature of the flats, the proximity to main bus routes along Woodchurch Road and Prenton Road West, it is not considered that the absence of parking would result in a level of harm to the living conditions of neighbouring residents as to warrant a refusal of planning permission. The site is located within walking distance of the traditional suburban centre along Borough Road and other nearby local amenities. There is also sufficient capacity within the immediate vicinity to accommodate a small increase in demand for on-street parking. The proposals are considered to be acceptable and recommended for approval. There is no petition in connection with this application.
Is there a ward councillor that would like to speak in this? If you could just state your name for the minute, please.
Thank you, Chair. My name is Tom Mulberry. I'm the Ward Councillor for Prenton. I'd just like to make a representation on behalf of the residents who have obviously asked me to do that tonight and sort of challenge the statement that's made in the recommendations that it doesn't affect the character of the area. As I'm sure you'll be aware, because you went on a site visit, the type of property in that area is semi-detached and terrace type property built in about 1905, Edwardian type property. That's always been traditionally used for residential family use, really. You know, it's never been used as flats or anything like that in the past, as I'm aware of. I know this sort of thing is happening quite a bit now due to lack of housing provision where these houses are being bought by developers and turned into flats, but this is quite an extreme example of that, which is a normal family house is being turned into 5 bed-sit flats, And how that doesn't affect the character of the area is beyond me, and it's beyond the residents who've made this representation, because of course it affects the character of the area, particularly if more development like this are allowed in that particular area. It doesn't become a residential area for family homes anymore, it becomes a residential area for flats and that type of stuff, you know. How it doesn't also affect the parking in that area is beyond me as well. I understand what the planning representative is saying regarding bus routes and train routes and all the rest of it. But each one of these people who are going to be living in the flats, and good luck to them, to be honest with you, because people have got to live somewhere, may own one car or two cars, who knows, you know, we don't know that in the future. And these particular areas, these particular roads have no off-road parking facilities. They have no driveways or off-road parking facilities, as far as I'm aware, unless they be modified or can be modified, which doesn't really happen in that type of area. So I have one representation from people who've got disabilities and parking bays in that area. And as you know, being members of the planning committee, parking bays are only there to be observed. There's no law to make people observe parking bays. It's only a recommendation that you don't park in them bays. So the real concerns of the residents in that area, and what has been expressed to me, is there will be parking situations that are going to arise if these people see fit to own cars instead of using public transport, as has been suggested. There will be crowding of wheelie bins, because you know you've got a normal family resident which would have one or two wheelie bins. This will obviously be five or six wheelie bins. So then real concerns are there, you know. So this is what the residents are asking me to really say. The crucial thing is that it will affect the character of that area. You've got to take into consideration that if this sort of thing is a growing thing, which it is, you know, you're going to have this type of thing all the time. How can you say it will affect the character of the area? Thank you.
Thank you, Tony. Can I open this up to committee? Comments? Matt? Sorry.
Just to say that I have real sympathy with what Tony said. This part of Prenton is not too dissimilar to parts of my ward, and in the sense that it has a residence parking area. There is, like Tony says, a move to chop up family homes into flats. I'm not sure, and I'll, you know, sort of take advice on this, but are there grounds to refuse it on parking? What is the policy in terms of the parking plan?
Thank you, through you, Chair. We have assessed the application against the council's policy for parking standards, and what that says is that if the development site is within walking distance of public transport routes and local amenities, then a shortfall in parking, or indeed no parking at all, is acceptable. I mean, just to put it in context, we did deal with an application, I think, in Councillor Fowkes's ward in Upton, which was the 10 apartments, and that had no parking, and that was refused by the committee on the basis of impact on residences' amenity, but that was quashed an appeal because the inspector felt that it was in walking distance, ready access of local amenities that include shops, the railway station, bus routes, and there is a drive by government to encourage people not to have reliance on the private motor car, but to use sustainable means of transport. And so we do have a condition that requires secure cycle storage and parking on the site, and as I said, it is within ready walking distance of a number of main bus routes on Woodchurch Lane and Prenton Road West. So it is in compliance with our with our policy on parking standards.
Thank you, Matthew. Steve?
Yeah, and that application you talk about has caused problems in that area because of the number of vehicles associated, not just residents but visitors and the like. My main issue then is the issue Tony was referring to about the nature of the area. I mean, I go on the site visit, so perhaps you can help me. Are many of these houses converted to 5 subletting flats? My worry would be as a ward councillor is if this house does it, sets a precedent, then if every house in that area suddenly becomes 5 flats, you have suddenly got an absolute complete change in nature of the area, and traffic will be an issue, maybe not because of this one application, but because of the precedent that this one application sets. And I know it's a growing trend and people can't afford to get on the property ladder, so they will start with a one bedroom flat and so on and so forth. So is there a reason for refusal to be created around the fact that this one application may set a precedent and create a situation where the nature of the area is changed to the detriment of existing residents?
Thank you, through you, Chair. You couldn't refuse a planning application because it's likely to set a precedent for a change in the character of the area. But as we've said before, as members know, each application has to be considered on its individual merits. I'm not aware that there's a predominance of flatted development in this area. So this application taken on its own wouldn't, in my view, couldn't be robustly defended in terms of a detrimental change in the character of the area. But it's a view for committee to reach.
Thank you, Matthew. Councillor Minton.
Thank you very much, Chair. I sympathise with everything that's been said, but unfortunately, we have to live within the guidelines that are set down. Our problems in this part of the world are set down in the South East, and it's the overheating and overcrowding in the South East, and what do we require? Down London government set policy for them. We have to live with the consequences. This is not new, it's something that we've had to deal with for years. Steve's quite right, but I remember the very first one I remember was for one in Wallasey Village Centre, which was a major classic development. We were amazed that there was no car parking at all, but it's within the government legislation. I take the point about starting the ball rolling and making sure that we run. This one we can't refuse, maybe 2 or 3 down the line, we can start saying there's a problem, I don't know. But as it stands at the moment, there's absolutely no reason to refuse it, in my eyes.
Pat?
Thank you, Chair.
Yeah, I was on the site visit, but we weren't able to access the rear of the property. And I think, you know, as has been pointed out, we are seeing a lot more of these kinds of applications converting larger properties into flats and bedsits, etc. So I think the conditions we apply are really important, actually. And I noticed, you know, it's already been mentioned the condition around cycle parking, which of course I feel very strongly about. But I'd just like the ward councillor mentioned the wheelie bins, and if there's 5 flats, presumably it could be up to 10 wheelie bins, plus the rear yard is supposed to accommodate the secure cycle storage. And I just wonder if we can see any plans that will kind of reassure us there's actually space to accommodate all of that.
Thank you, through you, Chair. But if we take this plan here at the top, the proposed first floor plan, that largely covers the outline of the site. So this area here would be the area identified for cycle storage and wheelie bins. This is the cycle provision, this is the bin storage, so it fills in that gap there.
assurance that the officer is content that there is sufficient space to accommodate?
For the number of units proposed, we are content with that space, yes.
Any other comments? Joe?
Just to clarify the situation, the apartment, did this come under the Tranmere Road as early as the residence apartment? So they would be allocated to apartment spaces on mass stages and well. Or be allocated to pair or
yeah, the chair space. Okay.
Any other anything else? No. The officer's recommendation is to approve this application. Do you have a mover for that? It is an SDA application. Thank you, Kathy. Do you have a seconder? Thank you, Eddie. All those in favour of approval? Against? That's carried.
Without
saying. Oh, sorry. Two abstentions. We move to agenda item 7, pages 59 to 64, North of Old Croft, Barnacre Lane, please. Matthew, can I have a presentation?
Thank you, through you, Chair. Again, this was another application that was the subject of a member's site visit on Tuesday. The proposal seek permission for the replacement of existing buildings with a new stable and a new workshop and storage building. Taking the new stable building firstly, so that's this building here. And this building will be located along the eastern part of the site, running north to south, facing into the site. The building will measure 18 metres in length, will be 6.2 metres deep, and will measure 3.2 metres at its highest point. There will be four stables accessed via an internal corridor. The stables will not therefore open directly onto the site. In comparison, the existing building is 16.5 metres long, 5.6 metres deep and 2.6 metres high. The new building is therefore 50 centimetres taller and 1.5 metres longer and 60 centimetres deeper. It will also be located 5 metres further into the site and off the boundary shed in the rear garden area of Old Croft. So this is Old Croft here, and this building will be pushed 5 metres further into the site. The second building, so that's this building here, is the storage and workshop, and will be built on the same footprint as the existing building. It will, however, be 4.7 metres high to its ridge, which is 1 metre taller than the existing building. This building has also been amended to remove windows originally proposed on rear elevation. The buildings on site are currently in some significant state of disrepair and have been used until very recently as stables and workshop and storage. Therefore, the use of the site remains the same. The new buildings are not disproportionately larger and will have no greater impact on the openness of the new belt. Concerns have been raised that the new buildings could be converted to residential use using permitted development rights applicable to agricultural buildings. However, such rights do not extend to buildings in equine use and related activity. Therefore, these buildings could not benefit from such permitted development, and any change of use to residential would require planning permission. Condition 6 restricts the use of the proposed buildings to those applied for and for no other purpose. The application is recommended for approval and there is no petition of objection.
Is there a word, Council, to speak on this?
Can I move approval?
Okay, can we have a second one? Thank you, David. Okay, the officer's recommendation ought to be approved subject to conditions listed. All those in favour? That's unanimous and carried. Can we move to agenda item 8, pages 65 to 68, 20 Devonshire Road, Oxton, please? Can I speak and have a presentation?
Thank you, through you, Chair. Planning permission is sought for the conversion of the basement into a two-bedroom flat. The building has been in use as flats previously, although it is currently vacant and in some state of disrepair. There are other basements in the area that have been converted into living accommodation, including the adjoining assembly next door. Off-street parking is provided and rear amenity space also. Objections have been raised in relation to the remainder of the building, and in particular its poor state of repair. However, this application cannot be used to enforce repairs to the remainder of the building, as the application relates only to the basement area. The proposal to convert the basement to residential use is acceptable and accords with policy HS13 in relation to flat conversions. The proposals are therefore recommended for approval, and again, there's no petition of objection on this application.
Is there a ward councillor? No? Okay, I'm going to committee. This is an SDA application.
I will move the recommendation to.
Thank you, David. Seconder. Thank you, Catherine. All those in favour of approval? That's unanimous and carried. Thank you. If we move to agenda item 9, pages 69 to 74, Ingleborough Road, Tranmere, please. Matthew, can you have a presentation? Steve's leaving because he's...
He's there with interest.
Yeah, but just looking for Joe. Oh. Anybody there? Not onto the table?
Somebody getting worse, but I'm not looking for them.
Thank you, through you, Chair. This application seeks permission for the remaining details of the redevelopment of the former playing fields on Ingleborough Road. Outline planning permission has previously been approved, which included the details on access. This application seeks permission for the approval of appearance, landscaping, layout and scale in relation to the 90 dwellings approved for the site. Objections received on this reserved matters application do not raise any new objections to those that were raised and considered in some detail by the planning committee at outline stage, particularly the issue of the site status as a memorial. These proposals retain the area of land in the northeast corner of the site to be used as a memorial garden. Condition 2 defines the permission having regard to those plans and conditions on the earlier outline permission, which are also still valid in extent. The council is continuing its discussions with the applicants in relation to the final details of the